The subject I'm going to speak to you today about is creating a culture of leadership in an age of disruption. We are very familiar with the fast-changing world around us. We know things are changing, and they are changing very fast. And yet, we are most reluctant to shed our old ways, give up our old habits, and adapt to this change. And sometimes, these changes come about so suddenly upon us that most of us are never ready for it. Let us take a few examples of disruption. And these are examples that you can all relate to. If you remember, there was a time when getting a telephone connection was a big achievement in the country. You had to wait many years. Then came the era in the 80s of the STD booth. And then the STD booth had dynamic pricing like airlines have today. And during the day, you had to spend a lot of money. And late at night, if you called, it came down to a quarter of the price. Today, STD booths are an extinct species because we have the mobile and now we have a smartphone. So therefore, many of the things that happened by going physically to some place are now being done by you on your mobile. But when this change happened, were you ready for it? Was society ready for it? How many people anticipated it? And there is a sad answer to most of these questions is a no. Why does this happen? Why is it that we cannot see disruption coming? There are certain reasons why disruption is not visible. Disruption happens when there is a complete shift in paradigm. And when there's a complete shift in paradigm, what has happened before that is that society has a high degree of competence in what they are doing. When they succeed, they have a high degree of complacency in what they have achieved. And when it comes in the field of education, we have a curriculum that is built around these skills. And then we are bound by that curriculum. And that curriculum doesn't change in time to see the change happening. So to give you an example, the Kodak film company used to make very fine films. And they kept making better and better films. And one day came the digital camera. And that was the end of Kodak Eastman company went into bankruptcy. Yet, there are others who are smart people. Take Wipro as an example. It started off as a Vanaspati ghee company. Today, it is a leading company in the field of IT and other services. There are many such examples that we can find. But what is unique about disruption today is the rate of disruption that is happening, the range of disruption that is happening. And therefore, the capacity for us to cope with this creates a large amount of, is a function of how we can deal with uncertainty. How adaptable are we? So are we educating the leaders of tomorrow for what is now known as 21st century skills? There are many, but I will just recap a few for you, which are commonly referred to as the four C's. And though you can take them in any order, but there is a sense of progression in this. The first is communication. You have to communicate an idea. You have to communicate your thoughts. Then you need to work in a team. So you need to have collaboration. Once you have collaboration, if you want to make a difference, you've got to critically think and analyze the issue at hand. So critical thinking is the third thing. And out of this churning of communication, collaboration, and critical thinking, we'll end up with a thing called creativity. So when you have creativity, what does it mean? That you've come up with something new, or you've come up with something different. Now this sounds very easy, but why is this needed? The OECD, the Organization for Economic Cooperation and Development, has listed the number one skill needed in the year 2020 as complex problem solving. Which educational system of ours today is preparing students for this? Complex problem solving. Therefore, if these critical, if these 21st century skills are needed, what are the barriers to having our new leaders quickly pick up these skills? First and foremost is our living in the past, because we learned a certain thing at a certain point in time. We were used to a certain thing at a certain point in time. So whereas we can learn the new skills, we fail to unlearn the old ones. And even after learning the new skills, for some time when you practice, you tend to go into a relapse and you go back to your old ways. Therefore, one of the biggest assets of a leader of the future is the capacity to unlearn. Anybody who has the capacity to unlearn while learning new things has a great potential to be a leader. Secondly, because in the world of disruption, changes happen so fast, and therefore it seems that somebody's idea has suddenly clicked and it has become viral, or it has become a big money spinner, there's a tendency to lose our moral compass. We tend to become unethical, to see quick fix results, which in the long run invariably backfire. I think you have seen examples of some of the best known people who are very well to do, who set up successful companies, now being in a position of embarrassment because the system they built up has unraveled on themselves. And the system was not built up on an ethical foundation. Along with ethical foundation, the next thing that is needed for a leader of tomorrow and what we need to educate them for is the concept of equity. And I please understand, I'm not saying equality, I am saying equity. That means everyone should have a fair opportunity to do what they have to do and a fair chance to achieve what they wish to achieve. Full equality is an idealistic proposition and it's unlikely to be achieved. But equity is definitely very much possible. And therefore, a system built on ethics, system built on equity, a system built on a sense of empowerment, and a system built with empathy. These are the four E's that you should keep in mind. If these four are met, we will have a better system tomorrow. The leaders of tomorrow will be grounded, and the leaders of tomorrow will be able to adapt to the changes that come at us. So then, how else do we now need to educate the leaders to deal with a world like this? First and foremost, as I said, there is a sense of complacency that comes out of current competence. We have to question, reflect and analyze that what can be done differently, what can be done better, what will make a difference. And to use a current jargon which is very commonly used, what will create an impact on society? If you can create an impact from your idea to impact, if this path is fruitful, you will find that you have a leader of the future. So what are these things? How do we educate the leaders to be able to move from idea to impact? First and foremost, we must have a mastery over what the current situation is. We must be able to analyze what are the deficiencies or where can those current systems be improved. And having identified them, what is that one big idea which is a game changer, but which is simple? But most importantly, which is executable. If your idea can't be implemented, it is no good an idea. Now, when you come up with a new idea and you experiment, you're bound to fail. in today's society, very often failure is seen as a stigma. Failure is seen as a bad thing. If you don't do anything, you will not make a mistake. If you don't make mistakes, you will never learn. So therefore, unless you are willing to take some risk, unless you're willing to fail and learn from that failure, not merely fail, then and then only then can we move towards providing leadership for the others. Along with failing, the important thing is to fail small. So pick up a small idea, experiment with it, and see if it works. And if it works, jolly good. It may be a fluke, you may be lucky, or it may be a great idea. But if it fails, from it, you will learn much, much more. But remember, always fail small. And when you succeed, if you succeed with this bright idea, then don't wait for it to grow over a long period of time. You need to scale up that idea quickly and swiftly to be able to be a success. In my younger days, a movie like Sholay or Dilwale Dulhaniya Le Jayenge ran for years on end in the same movie hall. Today, in a week's time maximum, the movie will be out. But they will show it on 1,000 screens all over the country. So if your idea has to succeed, if there's a video game that has to succeed, it succeeds in the first 24 hours, or it won't. So if your idea is smart, then you've got to be very scalable and very fast. There's a concept called blitz scaling. You've got to scale up rapidly and quickly if you have success. But if you fail, because you've had a small failure, you can absorb that failure and move to the next level. The final thing I wish to say to you about how to educate leaders in an age of disruption is to make our children understand that they are not in competition with each other, but in collaboration. Because there is a lot of room for everybody at the top. It is not a zero-sum game. That if one child succeeds, the other fails. No. Both the children can succeed. Today, our examination system tests everybody individually. But in the real world, success comes in a team or in a group. So therefore, educate your children to understand that the smartest leaders are those who know how to get work done from others and not necessarily to do it themselves. So in conclusion, remember, we have to trace out our path. You have to trace out our past, but we got to face our future. So remember the two differences, tracing out the past, but face the future. And that is where the future of educated leaders in a world of disruption will lie. Thank you.